I welcome this opportunity to share thoughts about Schubert, which are very relevant to playing any music that we're playing at any level. Schubert's music is perhaps the most sheerly beautiful that any composer has ever written. It's a joy to hear it, it's a joy to practice it, and it's a very big endeavor to get up and perform it. Schubert probably has more challenges in his piano music and more decisions to be made than anyone else, I believe. It wasn't written to be comfortable piano music. He was not a great pianist. He could play the piano, but when you think that Beethoven was a phenomenal pianist, Mozart was an outstanding pianist, Bach was a phenomenal keyboardist, Chopin and Liszt were legendary performers, Brahms was an excellent pianist. But Schubert was a singer. He was in the Vienna choir boys. He knew how to play the notes of the piano. But voice was his idiom. And he thought also in terms of string quartets and in symphonies. He wasn't sitting there like Liszt with a natural affinity for the piano and primarily wanting to write music that was specifically meant for the piano. Schubert is writing the music that comes out of his head, and it's our job to realize it. It also isn't suited for the modern piano. Our action is so very, very heavy. Even what we consider a light action piano, it's much heavier than what Schubert's piano was. Schubert's piano had no iron frame. A couple people could pick it up and move it around. The mechanism worked very, very differently. It's a totally different instrument from what we're expected to play it, to play the music on today. It's not meant for modern concert halls. He wrote for his friends. He meant for the music to be played at home or by oneself, not in a great big large concert hall. It is a totally different world that he lived in than what the music world is today. He also is really a classical composer. We often get into arguments about what's romantic and what's classic. In his case, he's right on the cusp. He really basically is what we term a classical composer. The school of Mozart is what really he was grounded in, and Beethoven. And yet there's a subjectivity with Schubert that still we can't say, oh, he's purely a classicist and do everything we do that we would do with Mozart with his music. He's stepping towards that romantic world and emotionally in many ways is in it, but he's not totally in it. With Chopin and Liszt, we use lots of pedal. Our default piano playing is with pedal. But with Schubert, it's not. Yet we need the pedal. So it's all these decisions that the answer really is compromise. The answer to almost every decision involving Schubert is you aren't going to get fully what you want. You're not going to get what you hear in your ear and what you desire to project. I consider it impossible to get 100% what we want. Chopin's piano was a little different from today's, but when we play a Chopin work with lots of pedal and so on, we can walk away from the performance on some days at least and feel we got close to what our goal was doing. You will never feel that when you play Schubert. You have to accept the fact that so many adjustments have to be made to realize it on today's instruments and in today's surroundings. He is full of charm, and yet we can't let it become too precious. He's full of intensity, but we can't let go and flail away with massive amounts of sound. There's so many details, but if all you focus on is the details, you're going to lose the long line. It's a very humbling thing to play Schubert, but it's rewarding because it's so beautiful. And it's a chance to give and share the beautiful music with others who aren't listening the same way we are. We hear exactly what we want. They're thankful and grateful to hear the message that comes out when we go through the sacrifice of playing the music. If you want to walk away feeling great about how you played, play Rachmaninoff, play Chopin, play Liszt, play Brahms, play music like that, which is kind of about the performer. When you play Schubert, when you play Mozart, when you play Beethoven, it's about the music. You have to reflect that music. It has to go through you. But it really isn't about you, and you will spoil it if you make it too much about you. Oh, look what I'm doing. Look what I've discovered. Look how much feeling I'm feeling at this moment. It'll wreck that music. That music is more like a religious text that you want to read it with expression, but you don't want to make it all about you, or it loses the greatness and becomes more superficial. And that's one of the scary things about playing Schubert. The music has to play us rather than us
making the music into something. And it's very hard to strike that balance where you can be so out of it in a sense that the music simply plays you and yet you're aware of everything that's happening in it. It takes a long experience with Schubert's music. And it helps a lot if you learn a piece, you rest it, you work on it some more, you rest it, you come back to it. And not just over one semester or one year, but really over a lifetime. So many things have become more clear to me about Schubert as I've gotten older, as I've taught the music, as I've learned different Schubert pieces, as I've gone back to the same pieces. Schumann said many things will only become clear to you when you are old, and I think that's especially true with interpreting Schubert. I am not a Schubert specialist at all. I've spent as much time thinking about other composers as I have about Schubert. But I think the older one gets, the more you get drawn to Schubert's music. You love it all through your life, but you really, really love it every year as one gets older. And some of these questions become clearer. I'm not here to give all the answers on Schubert. As I said, compromise is the answer. And different people come up with different answers. Some of these issues I'll touch on today, the world's top scholars argue about. And each one feels that they're right on it. But they all know that no one can be definitively right, because we're not sure exactly what Schubert did in many instances. And even if we knew that, maybe it's not in what's in the best interest of the piece today. So many issues just have to stay unresolved. I'm very thorough, and we're going to touch on just about everything that one considers when you play Schubert. But in terms of giving you the answers or giving the answers that everyone in the world agrees with, that's not going to happen today. I'll be really honest and open and sound opinionated about what I believe, but I give everybody else the right to what they want to believe. And I'm not going to insist that I'm right and they're wrong. Also, I reserve the right to change my own mind as the future evolves. There's things I'll say today that I didn't feel the same about some years ago. But with increased working with the music, I feel it a certain way now. But the great thing about an art, and not a science, it's more cast in stone, that's part of the art, that one evolves through their whole lifetime. The world of Schubert has to be understood to really understand the music, just as I believe it has to be understood for every composer. And you can't just play their piano music. You can't play the one piece you're working on without knowing the other piano music of any composer. Then you have to know their chamber music, their symphonic works, their opera, and then you need to know the world around them artistically, as well as aspects of their own personality. I don't think one needs to do a huge amount of study of Schubert the man. We only have about 70 documents relating to him, and it's not like Schumann, you could spend a lifetime figuring out that unique mind. The main thing about Schubert is that he had deep, powerful feelings, and he was very sincere and very genuine, not one to make small talk, but when he felt something deeply, he was outspoken and spoke with great fervor and intensity. His life was not an unpleasant one. In childhood, for people in those days, and in the early years of his adulthood. But in 1823, he realizes his life is going to be short. And there's a change. The music frequently deepens and becomes more tragic, more ominous in some cases. And with Schubert, the way it's gone through history is people had an image of this charming little fellow who wrote charming music and isn't acute. And they didn't realize the depth in Schubert until then, maybe the 1960s, people started to dwell on the fact, oh, there's a really dark side in his temperament, and let's emphasize how miserable he was, and neither extreme was correct. And to understand Schubert, you've got to get the joy, the sparkle, the dancing quality, the lightness that's a lot of it, but you also have to be alert for the tremendous profundity, the depth, and the tragedy that's in the music. He primarily wrote songs, there's 625 of them. He wrote chamber music, he wrote a lot of operas. He wrote 15 operas, but they're not performed today and they weren't successes in his own day. He spent a lot of time with them. And it's that music one needs to know. I urge you to go to our website, it's mentioned on the page here, and there's performances of six Schubert Lieder that you can easily access, and then there's performances from a recital here in January of 2015. And The singer's magnificent at leader. I was a collaborator on that. And I send you there because those are, I think, very communicative readings of those works. And also you can get the history of leader there, which is not an easy thing to find unless you're going to read very scholarly articles. But it's easy to read material. And you can't play a Schubert solo piece without having a feel for the leader. And it tells me that many of you are playing for singers who are singing Schubert. That will help your playing of Schubert's music every bit as much as the piano lessons that you get on that. But one has to understand that whole literary movement that was going on. The people of Vienna in his time, the intellectuals, felt alienated from the world. It was becoming more mechanical, less personal. And they felt very isolated and were retreating into their own feelings and into their own homes and their own world. They considered themselves wanderers through this strange material world and felt that the real world was nature and religion, and were obsessed with love, with death, with pain. All these human elements that were bursting into the literature at this time. And there was this word, Sehnsucht, an unquenchable yearning for what cannot be. That's what you have to feel in a lot of Schubert's music. Vienna of his time was a lot of dancing. Rossini's operas were very popular. The Congress of Vienna was meeting there to redraw Europe. And there was all this vitality, and the middle class started aping the upper classes in dancing. You want that dance element in Schubert, and if you don't have it, you're missing an important ingredient. The pianist had a saying, it is hopeless but not serious, which sort of reflects this certain pessimism that's behind this veneer of joviality. Also, Vienna was the capital of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and there's huge Hungarian influences in Schubert's music because of all the Hungarian influences that Schubert was exposed to in Vienna. He grew up in Vienna, and he's buried in Vienna. I hope you can get to the birthplace, the death home, just the room, and the central cemetery where Schubert is buried. They're very meaningful things to do, to be right smack on the same floor that he was born into and where he died. And then Viennese have the great composers all buried close together. The cemetery there. It's a very, very moving experience to do. Now, what else do we need for Schubert? A sound. We all think of the sound that we need for Chopin or for Debussy. Those sounds are easier because we've got so much pedal that helps our sounds float. And we can't use the pedal as a crutch with Schubert. We use the pedal, but it's very relatively little and not a whole lot. So we have to create a beautiful sound. It can't just be dry. And how do we get a sound in anything in piano playing? We have to have the mental concept. There's no substitute for that. No preconceived concept in your ear of what the sound of the piece should be, and you won't get beautiful tone, regardless how much you worked at tone physically trying to make something. It really comes from the ear. You have to ask yourself for it. You have to go over and over practicing passages until you feel you're getting it. But the disappointing thing is you move to a different piano and you're going to have to approach it a little differently. That's life as a pianist. But what's in your ear will project to the listener, even if you go to a different piano. It's having that concept, not just of what is the rhythm of my piece, but what sound do I want to come out when I make it. I like the saying, what the ear wills, the fingers produce. You have to believe that. That when you have that concept, and you work at it, the listeners can hear what we're going after. Harshness is totally out of place in Schubert. Any angularity is so very wrong. That music has to sing. He was a singer. We need to cushion the tones, to float the tones, to let them blossom. We have to seek a buoyancy. And we want to imitate a string quartet. And most of all, the human voice. And how do we do that? It's controlling from the key how fast we put down the key. All we as pianists can do, no matter how emotional we feel, all that comes out in playing in terms of the physics of what happens is how fast does the key go down and exactly when do we put it down. So it's really control that we need to have, which we get from feeling that speed of the key descent, which comes from experimenting. It's why we can't just drop aimlessly on a key. Or we can't be satisfied with a sound that's too whispered and doesn't project enough. We have to work at that. Also, finger individualization, where oftentimes people have been trained to really stress one finger at a time, will get in the way of the arm controlling really how we play the piano. We really play the piano with the arm and not the fingers. The arm moves the fingers. We have to feel a legato that connects from one note to the next note. And the wrist has to be so supple. My big frustrations as a teacher are seeing stiff wrists and fingers overworking all by themselves that aren't coordinated with the whole hand, and that the legato isn't taking place. I've had to work for all those things myself. They're not something I was born with. My frustration is that I want to find a way to help everybody get that. It's not that I'm angry at any students. It's I just desperately want to get across to others what I found was crucial to playing. And it takes a long time. It's not one easy lesson. But strive for those things technically. The arm, not the fingers, the wrist being free and being legato. It's crucial to find the right tempo for Schubert. I'm not going to say what the right tempo is, but you have to give a lot of thought as what is the right tempo for you, what you feel is the right tempo in the best interest of that music. One thing is looking at those words. I'm not so obsessed with believing that a word that Schumann used indicated a certain tempo. It indicated a mood. Brahms' words indicated moods. But back in the 18th century, there was like a code. There were guidelines that people accepted as to what an andante really was. What is an allegro? What is a presto? What is an allegro vivace? And this is dealt with in depth in the handout that doesn't talk about Schubert there. The Schubert one we're following along today with what I'm saying, and I made it as a guideline for you to refer to later. Because often if one attends something like today, it's stimulating at the time, but one forgets a few days or a few weeks later. But I hope you'll keep the rest of your life, the one on Schubert, to have with you when you practice. The other one is more for historical background, but it represents thousands of hours of work on my part to read the treatises written by famous musicians in the 18th century and try and dig out of those thousands of pages what's relevant to you, because I don't think you will have the time to read all of that. And what is summarized there is really what 18th century musicians thought and felt and expected their performers to play. So that's for study. Some of it's a little bit slow going, but it saves a lot of time and effort. It's relevant to Schubert. It's mainly oriented to a little bit before him historically, but it's still relevant. But Mozart was spent huge amounts of time changing allegro to allegro maestoso, or allegro maestoso to allegro, or andante to andante con moto. Those words are extremely meaningful. So I've sometimes heard students of any age say, oh, I want to play it the way I want to play it. Those words don't matter to me. As I say, I have a pretty open mind if it comes to Schumann, to Brahms, to later musicians. And also pretty open mind on Baroque music, because that's primarily rhythmic and work a lot of ways. But from doing a lot of research, to Haydn, to Mozart, to Beethoven, to Schubert, those words are important. Beethoven's a whole world in himself. And we're not going to talk about him today. He liked very fast tempi for the fast pieces. But the Mozart, the Schubert school, I believe, often gets played too fast in fast pieces. And I think those people from those days would feel so also. What's crucial also is when you're picking a tempo for Schubert, it needs to stay pretty steady for that whole piece. If you're playing a waltz that lasts a minute, a number of different tempi can work. But if you're doing a sonata that's going to take 15 minutes, you can't jump around for different tempi for different sections. So you're going to have to give a lot of thought what works for the whole piece. And often one little phrase can open the door to what that ideal tempo really is. You should sing the melodies. You should walk them while you're feeling them and thinking them. He might write a sonata, but you can often spot that there's something processional about it. Maybe it's really a march. Maybe it's a barcarolle. Maybe it's really a waltz, but not called a waltz. That can be a key. But give it enough space to breathe. Give it enough room to highlight details. These pieces have been performed thousands of times. But if we're going to reveal something in the music, we need time and we're not rushing through it. But we don't want to be so slow that it's not full of vitality and life. So flexibility over the long term of the piece, not very much. But I'm not saying it has to be metronomic from beginning to end. Slight deviations work, and within a given phrase, you've got room to maneuver in that. I often find people so metronomic when through their phrases, where we need room to breathe. Their phrases need to have a direction, a momentum. Sometimes we're going to push a little bit ahead to the goal in that phrase and relax afterwards. Sometimes the goal will be such that we want to build up to it and almost pull back the tempo before that goal. It has to be subtle. It's very, very almost microscopic, but you'll sense in a performance whether it has that freedom that breathes or whether it's just being a metronome. So be careful over the long range. You're not jumping all around, starting a movement at 88 and then going to 120 or something. Not right. But within the phrase, you've got a little room to breathe. Diminuendo also in Schubert implies a slight slowing. It's not a ritardando, but and that's not a commonly realized belief. But the evidence is there, as well as in some of the 18th century treatises. He almost never writes guitars, so if he does, we certainly should do it. But we have to be alert to where we feel a little bit of give. In order to hold the piece together, rhythm is just essential. And it's really the rhythmic aspects that make Schubert so tough, not just choosing the tempo, but even the rhythm within a dotted eighth and a 16th note. Exactly how long are we going to hold that dotted eighth? It's not always going to be 75%. Sometimes we're going to shorten that 16th note a little bit. Sometimes also, we are careless and don't hold the dotted eighth for even 75% of the value. It's very easy to turn a dotted eighth 16th note into a triplet. If you're going against triplets in the other hand, very frequently you do that and line them up. It's controversial, but that's often done. But if it's just unaccompanied, that's a crucial ingredient. You can hear a performance where the person has nice sound, but you feel something's not quite right. And it often is that dotted eighth 16th, or else some long notes are meant to be held and we clip them short. It's very, very easy for all of us to do at any level or experience of playing. Or there's a rest and we clip it short. It's so easy to do, and we have to watch out for that. And you might think of such tiny things that I'm talking about. In this style, they really add up in a way that maybe in Brahms it's not as obvious, or Rachmaninoff, but it is very obvious in Schubert. Also, syncopations need to be delayed, and often we don't. If we play something that's blatantly a waltz, the Viennese have a way of bringing that second beat a little early and delaying the third beat. It's kind of like a Chopin mazurka, and that's part of the style to know. We have to realize with the rhythm, if it's in three, we don't want to hear one, two, three. One, one, two, three. Basically feel three, four, unless it's incredibly slow and one to the bar. That can transform a piece right there. These people thought in terms of strong beats and weak beats. They thought in strong measures and weak measures. And it's what makes this music tick. It just won't work to say, I like this piece, I kind of feel this piece, and play it. Some listeners may get something out of it because they're pretty melodies. But there's a structure, and really, music interpretation is about structure. People often talk music interpretation is like painting. It's much more like architecture. I'm not an architect, I can't discuss that, but you do know what I'm saying. It's the structure of the piece, horizontally, vertically, that makes it work or not. It's relationships. The notes are not all equal. We have to find what are the priorities rhythmically, melodically, and harmonically. And especially with Schubert, it says harmonies. There are so many unexpected harmonies. There's so many harmonies that emotionally move us so much. We have to know where they are and prepare them. So we can't just walk through them. We have to be like a driver who realizes there's an obstacle up ahead and I'm going to have to slow down. You can't just suddenly jerk on the brakes and cause an accident. People do that in Schubert sometimes. Suddenly they're so slow. The piece is ruined in a certain sense because there's a unity. But if you decide, I'm just going to keep that tempo steady, it won't work. So you have to know where those chords are, and if you don't know theory, the piece will not work. That's why you're taking theory in the classes, so that you can apply it in your pieces. I don't even like the word theory because it sounds like something different from music. You're taking music, you're looking at music, and you're going to, it's your job to apply it to the pieces. And if you don't hear what a German sixth is and know what a German sixth is, you're not going to perform it. If you don't know what a Neapolitan is, or even if you know it in a theory class and get 100 A+ for all the tests going well, if you go play a piece that has a Neapolitan in it and you don't play it with a special preparation and a special dynamic, the theory was a waste. You're supposed to put it into practice. And it's a great joy with Schubert especially because of these tremendous chords. So many of them are mediant chords related by a third to your tonic. A whole section will move from C major to A flat. He'll unexpectedly go to chords that are shocking. So we can't walk through them and figure, well, they'll just speak for themselves. We're like the tour guide who takes somebody through a museum and says, look over here. I want to call your attention to a certain thing. So we know where it is. We know the timing, how we're going to do it. That's our job. And we need, in a sense, in our own mind, a map of where we are in the piece. No matter what key you're temporarily in, you need to keep in mind, what was your tonic? How does that key relate to the tonic? The tonic might have been left a long time ago, but you've still got to hear it in the back of your mind. There's more details that you can read and study later in the handout. I'm going to play examples that'll put these to use, but I'm going through the text first, and then we'll have examples for the rest of the time today. In dynamics, literally follow them. Chopin changed his all the time. I'm not bothered with I or a student decide to make an alteration. Schubert's our structure. We need to follow everyone. There's a huge amount of pianissimo. There's a huge amount of triple piano. And we have to really observe every one of those and make a huge effort to make the piano and the pianissimo as close as we can get to actually do that. The articulation markings aren't put there just out of tradition. Very often the first note of a slur is played a little bit longer and a little bit louder. Those articulation marks are meant by Schubert. Staccati, we often are too dry with them. They need to flow, they need to be warm. He puts a huge number of accents in the music, and they're there because he wants us to stress that note. Doesn't mean it's a percussive accent like you might find in a 20th century composer. But if we avoid these accents, it's like speaking a bunch of syllables where we haven't stressed any of them. We're just saying meaningless syllables. And he knows where he wants those stresses. He's got sforzando sometimes, and we can't just walk through those, but we can't be overly harsh with them. And there's a little misunderstanding on a lot of the notes where there's the slur and a dot underneath it, that portato. Later, that's more of something between staccato and legato. In Schubert's time, it's saying each one of those notes needs to be stressed. So I hear people often making those very, very short, where it's more that each one is sort of a word in itself. We'll discuss the ornaments when we come to them. And it's so important always to listen for balance and control the lower registers that tend to move on, that boom on the modern piano. We also don't want to be aware of what is the bass line doing. It's not just melody. The pedal is an enormously complex decision, and you have to sample on the given piano that you're playing in terms of getting a little bit so it's not too dry, but not getting it too muddy. And then you work out in your practice room or at home exactly what seems right. Then you move into a concert hall with a different piano. You've got to rework that. But when you do pay close attention to that, it makes a huge difference. Because I've heard beautiful concepts of pieces worked on, and the person way, 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 way over pedals it, and they just smeared all the detail work that they did. But it's not more like Mozart or Bach. Oh, I'm not going to need the pedal very much. Because you need that pedal, or if it's too dry. Schubert uses the word sordini for a certain type of pedal they had that made an incredibly soft sound. Sort of like on the vertical, on the upright pianos, the vertical pianos, when you put down that middle pedal, sometimes you get a very, very soft sound. They had that on his pianos then. That's sordini. Verschiebung is like the unicorda. You sometimes see that written there. That shifts over like ours today. A lot of repeat signs in Schubert. I have a lot of written material there about taking repeat signs. The bottom line is be practical. Know your audience, whether it's a wise thing to take a lot of repeats or not. And I've talked about all these things that sound intimidating and scary and intellectual and academic. They're all crucial to a great performance, but we have to remember to enjoy the music. Ultimately, when we're sharing the music, we did all this thought, it's the background. It won't, the details, many of them won't come out. We won't get 100%. What we have to remember when we're sharing the music is enjoy the music ourselves. Trust the other people will enjoy it, and play with the music. A lot of it is humorous. And I will say a famous quote from Shakespeare, I'll drown my boat. It's the end of the tempest. And ultimately, that's what we have to do. All this work goes into preparation. But when we communicate, we have to rely that much of that preparation will come out. And that ultimately, it's about letting the music us and not overthinking at the moment that we're actually doing it. That's the hard thing of being a real artist, because there's no substitute for the discipline, the detail, the study, the tearing everything apart. But it's not an end in itself. There's really three stages. When you're young, you play for fun. You enjoy it. It's emotionally rewarding and fulfilling. Then you learn how music's put together, and you want to win because there's so much to think about and there's so much to try and realize. And when standards go from, oh, I had fun, it must have been a good performance, to a real performance is up here and I'm just down here, is this even worth it? But you have to stay with it and utilize those details and realize their means to real artistry. And when you can get some of the time, artistry being realized, that's what it's all about. You will never get a performance you're happy with every note, and you're feeling just the music take you over for a whole 7 or 8 or 10 minutes, it won't happen. But even for a period of seconds, if that music is really quality music making, it's not an egotistical thing, but it's a very good feeling. And that's what we work towards, ultimately. So you're at the hardest periods of your life right now because you're getting bombarded with information where once music was fun and it was out an outlet. And then you incorporate all you learn and it does come together later in life. But you can't skip that second stage. I mean, you can if you want to still enjoy playing the piano. You don't have to go through the long second stage. But if you want real artistry, unfortunately, it's not a shortcut. But when we do get up to perform, it's in the back of our mind what we soul searched about, what we practiced, what we drilled. Then we have to remember to enjoy it. Also, on your sheets there, Schubert's most significant piano music, other things to listen to, quotes on his own playing, interpreters to listen to, books that are worth reading. And for your benefit, since there's a lot of verbiage on these first several pages, your last page there is a quick checklist. I tear that off, take it to practice rooms with you, maybe the rest of your life, because I've tried to codify what is musicianship, what is great piano playing. And it's really, I feel, these means. So there's not a lot of verbiage there, but if you have that as kind of a checklist, have I done this for the pieces that I'm playing? I think you'll have quite an outstanding performance. I'll just do a little bit with some Schubert waltzes, because that's where people should start off. They want to jump to a sonata. But they epitomize the joy and the fun of life, and they were what he improvised for his friends. And we still have the same ingredients. Five means to resolve to one. That's musicianship 101. If you've got a dominant and a tonic, don't play them the same. Find the difference with it. Thank you.
but it helps to have examples. So when we have this in a second time, a little bit less, we wouldn't want to play the same gesture twice. We wouldn't talk and say the same words the same way twice in a row. Also, German dances, waltzes, they're all pretty much the same thing. We've got four consecutive eighth notes there. I don't play them squarely like that. I take a little bit of time at the beginning. And so in there. And of course, the left hand, soft on the second and the third beats with each of them. When you get gestures that come down, second measure, louder or softer. So you make longer units. The basic unit's a four-bar phrase. But when we have 2 plus 2, we can relate, and then, well, as I was showing, we can relate this to this, and even the two phrases. Schubert marks one of these to have quite a bit of pedal. That's very unusual, but we want to take advantage of that. The second time through, you might pull out the alto voice in there. Highlight the soprano first time, alto the second time. Also, we get this the same notes. Second time, or do you want a little more the second time? Your choice. In louder shapes. Oftentimes people will attack this piece so thick, so big, I think they're playing Brahms concerto or something. With these more intense fortissimos of Schubert, not too much bass, or it'll just thunder and take, and there's a lightness sometimes. That kind of thing, but it's again, I'm underplaying the left hand, but not having too much. time you're playing 3-4. The third beat is not heavy, or you've killed it, you've weighed it down, but the third beat is just loaded with energy. The downbeat's your arrival. So it's really the third beat, like you're hitting a ball that's going to go over a net or a bar of iron. Then it lands heavily, and not heavily, but it lands with a purpose, like our downbeat, but it's how you set it up on that third beat. And the second beats are short. So when you get something... Or it can get so busy with all the jumping around. so often I'll hear that note greatly shortened. And then you have to match what's left of that long note. One's musicianship will go enormously higher in playing if you're just aware that everything decays on the piano. We're stuck, we can't crescendo a note. So when you have a long note, that next note can't come in with an accent. And even if we think we're being sensitive but really aren't matching it, it'll be too loud. And even the start of the piece, you don't want to come in with that first note. You have to match nothingness. You have to match silence. Or really what's best, match the end of your previous piece, the listener, and you should still have that C major in your ear. So then you hear, that's going to be the next sound you hear. And here, there's the little appoggiatura. It should be on the beat, but played very lightly. I feel is to pedal through it. I tried to make that work. It doesn't. I'm looking for the big picture of it. You can still get a separation and a little bit of stress on that second note. I think that spoils the mood on today's pianos. On his piano, I played not his own piano because he didn't have a piano. He mooshed off his friends and if they had a piano, fine. If not, he held it out and composed out of his head. But from pianos of those times, and you can get this to work well. It doesn't on today. So it's compromise. And the goal with Schubert in terms of sound is draw your listener to you. Don't project out like it's Rachmaninoff or something. Draw the sound, make the time stand still. And so on with that. Looking at the third one, it's really a little, it's like a fiddler on the roof. Piece. It actually was entitled Russian Air, though I don't think it was an authentic Russian Air. And you want to play it like it's a full piece. Thank you.
thirds are very difficult in that. The trick with them is hang on the first note and then move the remaining 3/16ths ahead to the next beat. If you're trying to attack them as four square notes, it doesn't be musically or technically as satisfying in there. The next one is often rattled off, and it makes no sense. Natural swing.
the trio. Again, very little on the upbeats. I'm really hearing the structure F, E flat, D. Oops, I put the note too short in there. It's so easy to happen. And so on in there. I'm going to throw in a piece just briefly for fun. A Hungarian melody. I played just a little bit of it, but it's not extremely well known, but people really enjoy it. Impromptus are magnificent pieces. This first one opens with this fermata. Hold that forever. Number in the beginning, then down around page 40, well, even before that, 39, he's going to go the magic D5. Now here's an example where the music wants to move ahead a little bit. Can't take a new tempo, but you cannot, I don't believe you can find a tempo that's identical at the opening and what's in here. The opening you feel more a 4 to the bar, this flows in a 2 to the bar. And this is typical for Schubert. You want to hear this moving bass. It's a duet.
Thank you.
and then you get a different voice, then you get the same register as the first one, but a little different sound. So in the middle, it's very, very dramatic. You have to be careful not to overpedal. The next one you usually hear on recordings, rattle off. I think the significance of the piece is the bass. You're looking at the E flat. Schubert loves to use these little syncopated notes on the second beat, but what I'm really following is the bass line. That's really what holds the piece together. Instead of feeling that the music flows a little. One.
I mean, you're not going to find many pieces in that unless you're going back to the Renaissance. The obvious reason is it deals with the accentuation. He wants a stress here. He does not want this next act note accent. If he puts a bar line, the default stress goes on the first note of a measure. So you're going to get. So by having these long measures, I would play this piece about 63 to the half note, by the way.
Thank you.
unending, painful quality that you find in winterize of the song cycles. One other quick one, because it's one that's often taught and played, the A-flat of 142, number 2. Very hymn-like, but it needs to move because in your middle section, middle can move ahead slightly, but not too much. I want to finish today with the B-flat Sonata, which one could talk about endlessly, but it's one of the great, great glories of the whole music world. In any time you're playing a sonata, you have to know where your keys are and use that as destination points with it. This particular sonata has it's a journey through life, and we have to give it enough space to breathe, but you have to hold it together. It's something pianists work a lifetime to work with. Just the opening theme really comes from another world. Terrifying, now it's consoling.
one. So kind of set up that great hymn-like theme that now is in full splendor after being whispered. But what does he do? He's back in the stomach. What do you know from your sonata form? You want to go to F. You're in a B-flat work. Of course you're going to go to F, and it's about time to go to F. What does Schubert do here? Such a pain and an anguish, and at times, I mean, an anger in Schubert. So that's a very hard spot. You can't just beat the piano, but you can't hold back. And he wants the notes cut off. Normally, I would put a nice sound on it, but he's not feeling nice when he's there. And then the fermata. Yeah. He returns his. Single note, a forte piano. You can't hit it percussively, but you can't be too docile. Now comes the spot pianists all argue about. He's got about 8 bars in there that take you back to the opening to repeat everything you've been through before. And he also has a spot in the trill. Fortissimo. There are pianists who say that repeat must be taken, but it's a 15-minute sonata first movement if you don't take it. If you do take it, you're over 20 minutes. By the time you play the whole sonata, you've increased it from about 36 minutes to 40 or 41. For some listeners, it's too much. I don't take the repeat. I'm a practical musician, and practicality always wins the day for me. So I go on at that spot, and here he's... C sharp minor. Remember that when we go to the second movement. And there's these little duets. I mean, that's a crucial voice in there. The right hand's doing nothing. The
miraculous writing. And it's so simple in a way, because it's just this deep line that you built up to so big. And you get your opening theme. And then this, he's only going to go back to the same opening theme and the same opening key we had at the beginning. But it sounds so far away. So beautiful. Oh, no, just entering before.
Thank you.
trio, but right at the end. Remember the opening of the C minor impromptu, we had that G octave. Totally different piece, but remember also at the opening of this, you had that G to F. Here we get G again, with waiting after. Now this is a piece in B-flat, and we get a G, and a G7 of C minor. Remember, I said notice back in the beginning of the piece, we had G, G-flat, and F. The rascal's doing the same thing. I play it the same, and then we take a little bit of, I take a little time, at least G flat. Now I'm here, I expect the beat, and then this ominous octave.
Become a part of it and to share it with others. Thank you very much.